And then the last one, the nine of course, management report, Tom, it's you.
This is the final report for 2014-15. Again, standing before the end of the property in Sweden, which was titled, I know we've got to the performance of range, that's a great item last year. Six management, that's a piece of tennis from the law. In terms of the review of performance, that's all set out. It's quite clear though for the red indicators back from last year. Again, efforts have been made in 2015-16 current plans to improve those. For a target in the direction of plans, which have been revised, we've got changes in the methods of law. In terms of detail, it just reflects the performance in 2014-15. If there are any questions, I'll come and take them.
So there's no questions or comments from members. We can move to the recommendation. Cabinet's an open concept. Steve, no, did you want to?
I mean, can we, in all honesty, as a school committee doing our job properly, not make or probe the question why we've got people, because it looks like a block of beds on the one department's top. I don't think it's been cruel to anybody, yeah. But to the problem that there's an HR meeting. Fundamentally, I'm not posing the question, have we got the resource to deliver the targets within HR? If that's a fundamental question and is answered honestly, then we need to know that. But I'm aware that these performance blocks were a problem last year. I wasn't here the year before either, so I don't know how you perform then. But when you get consistent there for a period of time, you do genuinely need to challenge the fundamentals of whether we're capable of performing. Or are the targets so unrealistic that they will never be achieved? And they're the sort of questions we should ask. We can't just say, oh yeah, we're going to set that off against consistently and all the way. That's my advice to the school to do.
So, Chris,
what's
the
answer?
But in terms of they might be targets under HR, but Chris is responsible for delivering all of them. Then Chris is responsibility.
That's helpful information out of process.
So Chris provides the information to directors to get them to do. We've not seen the performance appraisal before and the issue there about how we drive it through. It's part of the concept, it's all part of the culture, the first of the organisation. It's all part of that management culture. Are managers doing appraisals? Are we giving the citizens absence? Are we larger absence? Are we encouraging the management development programme? Are we encouraging staff to do the training, so on and so forth? It's all part of that. And linked with the new appraisal process that came out this year, on lots of those areas are factored into that appraisal. So that's why I think it's really critical that all managers should be doing them this year. It's not only the council vision, get some of these basics right. And that's why it's so important, I think all managers should be following this, and all staff should have an appraisal.
So if I just take the side out here, and of course, no harm to Steve's point about whether or not these new areas are achievable and whether or not we get to the point where we can't achieve what we want, and that's looking again.
That's just whether achievable, then perhaps are the aspirational. It's what a good organisation should aspire to. So we don't set a high target, we all achieve it, but some of those on terms of the appraisal, I think I made a comment in the committee last cycle. The ambition to do everybody in an appraisal was perhaps challenging, particularly if you say individuals like school cost patrol staff. Is it realistic to sit down school cost patrol attendants and sit there to be 2 hours to do appraisal when they're probably about 3-4 hours a week? It's sort of getting that balance right to serve it. They'll no doubt be getting managed by the
closer they get smaller than the lollipop.
It's those sorts of issues, so I think that part of this basic question needs to come out of that. But are they challenging? Yes, they probably are. Should they be challenging? Yes, they should be. But it's that, my view, it's that to manage to make sure this happens. Yeah.
Chair, is this not an item that we could ask the coordinating committee to look at in detail, because it crosses all departments? Is that not something, rather than just dealing with it as an HR issue, is it not something we should pass on to the coordinating committee and ask them to consider how we move forward on it, as well as follow up on as we as
resource education and the resources side of the equation. There's no reason why it couldn't be coordinating, and it's a matter for, I guess, both committees and chairs maybe to consider and decide whether it's more suitable to sit with the coordinating committees.
It's just that it's more of a scary relationship.
Chris,
you're
last again.
Just an observation on this issue, really. These appraisals are something that are rather important, and if you cannot do them all, if you set the target so low, it's pointless exercise, you're not going to get any information out of it. You either do 100% or as near as you can get it. If you set it too low, it's absolutely a waste of resource, time, effort. So there's an alternative way of doing it, if it's a point to point saying, if it's at the staff levels that we have, if it's unachievable to aim for 100%, it's not unachievable to aim for 100% of a different tier. Do it step down. So I'm still trying to do that entire organisation as 100%. Do the first three levels of management, or the first two levels of management, and make that the target at 100%.
Well, then we are agreeing that to take this. This is obviously a real concern. Yeah. Yeah. We are going to be taking this to major in the job. So there's no
question on the panel. On TRD1PO9, the exception notices on the access for information. That looks as if it's starting to slip again. Is there any reason?
Yes, the reason for why we have these exception notices is because under the Access to Information Regulations, we are required to give 38 days notice of any key decision or indeed any decision that the executive is relying upon, which is its own information. And we do rely on publishing that on the form of the where we are not able to give that 38 days notice for whatever reason, then the regulations do permit for exemption notices and exception notices to be obtained, which requires the approval of the chair of the relevant policy and performance committee. What we have done is deliberately tried to introduce a target so that the need for such notices, which means that the public have been given less than 28 days notice by a key issue, this key decision, and the zone information matter. We've tried to utilise the performance arrangements to review to try and introduce a greater discipline to make sure that notice is indeed given as required so that we don't need to fall down and fall on these exemption notices. So that was a deliberate attempt to ensure there's greater discipline around the access to information laws and not fall back on use of these general and exception notices. And it does fluctuate. It will fluctuate by way of cycle because depending on how many kind of meetings you may have, for example, you may end up with a spike at a particular month for a very short period, but they're not even out during the course of the year, and indeed that was the case last year. But throughout the year, you'll find that we did, once or twice, exceed our projected target, but overall, we came in on target in terms of what we seek to achieve. So we do keep the matter under review, but I readily keep an eye on that, not least because we do get often challenges from time to time. Various quarters around ensuring that the relevant notifications are provided in good time and the regulations are complied with fully.
Thank you. Are we happy to the contents of the report?
No, really.
Agenda item on the town screen programme. The report there is in front of you, it's quite convenient. As I mentioned at the beginning of the committee, that we're undertaking by the local welfare system, two on this report, the local welfare system scheme and the policeman and the commissioner's group review. The local welfare system scheme report went to Cabinet in June. The update on the implementation of the recommendations of the FOI's group review that was completed in April last year was presented at the last committee. A further update will be provided later on in the year. As I previously mentioned, we're in the process of arranging new dates for a work programme, a workshop, which will the core panel will be folks, vice chair and chair. All of the members are advised to attend, but they'll have to kind of be able to influence what days it is for the contributing on the Commonwealth plan. And that's the opportunity for people to either come and present their own particular areas of concern, which we might set as a piece of task and push, or pass on to their folks what they would like us to look at. My recommendation for the committee is that we give delegated authority to members attending the work programme session to determine and prioritise work programme items. No, the work programme workshop is available to all members. The date will be determined by the core panel, which is spokes, chair and vice chair, because I'm trying to get everyone else to agree with data, so it's probably in my mind.
We've got the date reserved for all members.
Once it's agreed, we'll then set data and then everyone else wants to come on.
Okay.
Are there any questions or comments on
that? Just on that, I suggest, again, if you've got a common theme, yes, I have been, maybe we've got a common cause of we should be doing a weekend student committee to achieve the corporate plan, so happy workshop, please, and work for it.
Absolutely. Well, I have no time for any other business, so I'd like to thank everyone for their time and patience. It's been quite long.
Thank you.
Thank you.